New Mexico has one of the highest, if not the highest, teen pregnancy rate in the nation. What are we doing wrong?
Well, you know, you also have had a big decline, so I think you're doing some things right. And you're not the worst. You know, you,
well, <that's laughs>
you may be in the top five. You know, it's hard to say. It's hard to say. I mean, in sort of a biological sense, what it means is that there is a whole lot of teenager and a lot of teenagers having sex without using contraception and getting pregnant. I mean, in sort of at the end
Thank
of the day.
Thank you for breaking that right down.
You know, no, but I mean, I guess people sometimes need to get straight. That's what's going on. You have a large number, like most states, of sexually active teens, particularly in the late teens, 18, 19, and they're using contraception some, but they're not using it carefully enough. And you may have some serious pockets of poverty. You have a large Native American population, which has always had very, very high rates. So there's a lot going on here, and I think the most productive way to think about this more is, you know, why have you had a sort of a 33% decline in teen births in the last sort of 10 years? To look at what's working and not worry too much about why we might be, you know, the worst or in the top 10. You have had progress in the last few years, significant progress, and I think we should look at that and say, well, what has been working and what can we do more of?
Well, you know, it strikes me that, you know, in talking about teenagers out there who are having sex but not using birth control,
right,
that there are two things to look at. One of them is trying to get teenagers to not have sex.
Absolutely.
Or trying to get them to use birth control. How are those things related? Which should we be doing? Both?
Well, you know, the national teen pregnancy and birth rates have gone down significantly, between 30 and 40%, depending on which measure you're looking at, since the 1990s. And I'm always asked, why have the rates gone down? And the answer is it's both of the things that you just mentioned. Both some decline in the proportion of teens having sex, especially teenage boys, believe it or not. A little bit, not an enormous amount, but just a little bit. And a significant increase in contraceptive use amongst the teens who are having sex. So the short answer is less sex and more contraception. Both drive down teen pregnancy and birth rates. I think, as best as we can tell, it's the latter explanation, sort of more contraception, has probably played a larger role. But you're absolutely right. Encouraging young people to postpone sex is a very, very good idea, especially when we look at middle school young people. I think it's absolutely the right thing to do. But we also know that by the time we look at 18 and 19-year-olds, for example, who are in the teen pregnancy rate, that's 15 to 19-year-olds, somewhere between 60 and 80% of those teens are having sex or have had sex in the recent past. And so for those young people, I think we can encourage some of them to maybe, you know, not have sex right now or not tonight or not in this relationship. But for them, the larger focus has to be on contraception.
I had a fascinating conversation today with some of the students that I'm teaching here at UNM in the journalism department. We were talking about this topic. They gave me a bunch of great questions for you. We talked about MTV's Teen Mom.
And 16 and pregnant, I bet.
And 16 and pregnant.
Right.
And it was interesting, in the class, some of the kids said, well, I think these shows are glamorizing pregnancy and they're making it look cool.
Mm-hmm.
And one girl in the class said, have you ever seen it?
That is the exact right answer.
Right.
We hear this often, or at least we're asked that often. We actually do some work with both those programs. And I have, generally, it's someone who's sort of all grown up, not an adolescent. They'll say, just what you said, don't those programs glamorize? Because after all, these young women and their boyfriends or families or whatever, they're on TV.
Right.
Some of them are on the cover of Hello magazine with hair and makeup, you know, the whole thing. We have always said exactly what your student said, which is, have you watched it? I find it impossible for anybody to watch either one of those and come away thinking, gee, that looks like fun. That's going to help my life improve.
All the students, they were completely on the same page saying it's horrifying.
It's terrible. And, you know, it's not just that so many of the men boyfriends leave, which is the common story of adolescent pregnancy, but there's conflict with parents, conflict with girlfriends, school problems. But what I want to tell you is that we were asked that so many times that we thought we need to ask teens themselves. You know, we don't believe it. We'd say, have you seen it? So we did a survey of adolescents and of ones who had seen the program. And we said, do you think these programs glamorize sex? Series of questions. About 85% said, No, no way, never, not at all, just what I would have guessed. They said that for some of them, it was really the first time that they had been confronted with what this problem really looks like.
If you do get pregnant, you kind of drop out. You know, you drop out maybe of school, but largely you drop out of your social scene, and mm-hmm. so your friends really don't get mm-hmm. to see too much mm-hmm. of what happens.
That's right.
So and unless they're watching on MTV, they might really not have any idea of what it really is like on a daily basis.
That's right, and that's why this reality show format has been so powerful in many areas, you know, not just adolescent pregnancy, but other parts of life. Now, here in New Mexico and in other parts of the country, there are a number of schools who provide on-site daycare for the children of teen mothers so that they will stay in school, which of course is one of the main reasons we all worry so much about this problem. But even so, they are, in a sense, as you just pointed out, they're sort of separate, because maybe while their colleagues and friends are going to sports or something, they're in parenting classes. That's good for their child for sure, but it again, even if they're in that school, they're on somewhat of a separate track. And they can't go out in the evenings and, you know, weekends and so forth. I mean, maybe they can a little bit, particularly if the grandmother is helping out.
What effect do these programs have when you have schools that make accommodations for students with kids? Is that like, oh, it's easy, no problem. They have daycare at school. I can have this kid. Does it make it easier for them? I mean, does it have any effect on the rate, or does it just make it easier for parents once it's all said and done?
Well, you know, it's a very important question. What is the effect, not just on the teenage mothers themselves, but also on the young women in school who haven't gotten pregnant? You know, some of them look at these teen mothers and say, well, wait, why are they getting tutoring and all this extra support? I don't have a child, and I'm not getting as much help as I need. There are lots of complicated dynamics. But I think as a general matter, anything that can help a young woman stay in school and not drop out is going to be beneficial over time.
So when we're looking at the fact that our numbers have gotten better here in New Mexico, maybe not as fast as in some other places, and maybe right. we're still kind of at the back of the pack, but they have been improving. What are some of the things that we're doing right?
Well, you've done a bunch of different things right, and I hope it continues. Maybe you'll be down in the lower half, you know? Half of the states have to be in the lower half, and you should be one of them. Several things. First of all, you have invested in evidence-based programs. You know, a lot of people have been working on this issue for a long time, and I think we're finally beginning to have an understanding of what works. So we have things, for example, like Plain Talk, the teen outreach program. There are a number of them. And they actually have been shown through very good research in other parts of the country to work. And New Mexico has somewhat systematically put some of these programs in place, which is terrific. A lot of people, very well-meaning, just sort of make it up at the kitchen table. You know, they sort of take a little bit of this and a little bit of that, or they do what they sort of feel intuitively is right. And I'm not saying those aren't useful, but when, you know, money is tight, time is limited, and New Mexico has chosen to look at the evidence of some of these interventions. So that's great.
Let me ask you, what is Plain Talk?
Well, Plain Talk is one of these evidence-based programs that teaches parents in particular about what's going on in the lives of their children, middle school kids and high school kids, and talks with them about how to talk with their own children about sex, love, and relationships, family experience, values, culture, and so forth. Because what we hear from parents all the time is that they know they should be talking with their young people, they get that, but they literally don't know how to do it. In the most recent year, I think where we have good numbers, you had almost 5,000 births to teen girls in this state. It's a small state, that's a lot.
Yeah.
And we need to get that down.
About the school-based health centers. Mm-hmm. Now, there are some parents who say, hang on, you're giving out birth control to these students in high schools, you're just making it easier for them to go have sex, and we don't want them to have sex.
Well,
why are we doing this?
As the mother of three girls, I want you to know that I think that is a very reasonable question for parents to have. And it's been an enduring question. I mean, not just health services, but people have often thought, well, if we have good sex education, not good, if we have a form of sex education that talks about sort of every little thing, isn't that going to encourage young men and women say, well, gee, I want to try that. So I think about 20 years ago, there began to be a very focused effort in the research community to see if the presence of a health center, which you just mentioned, or the presence of certain sort of more comprehensive forms of sex education, did they actually encourage young people to have sex? I think it's an important question. The good news is that it does not. As a matter of fact, you get two benefits. It leads to a delay in having sex. And then for those young people who do have sex, they use contraception better so that they have lower rates of pregnancy and also sexually transmitted diseases. Now, I think an average parent would say, well, how can that be if if it's all out there, sort of, the services and the education? We have to understand that our young people live in a very complex environment. Turn on the TV, look at any magazine in the grocery store. They are surrounded by sexual content all the time. So the notion that they're not marinating in this is just not realizing what current American culture is like, and to say nothing of online and internet material. These clinics, these programs, the good ones, they take these issues on directly. They do talk about delay, they talk about risk, they talk about relationships, they talk about commitment, all the things we really do want them to understand that popular culture is not serving up.
In terms of the media, is there anything positive going on besides 16 and Pregnant and Teen Mom shows, reality shows about what really happens when you have a baby as a teenager? Is there anything positive in this stew that they're marinating in of half-naked celebrities on the covers of magazines?
Right, all the celebrities who seem to have sex all the time and there are no bad consequences. There has been a huge outpouring of commitment by media leaders on Nickelodeon, on CW, on Dr. Drew, Dr. Oz, in magazines, Us Magazine, all these things that we think about. The Warner Brothers people have been fantastic. All throughout media land, there have been programs concentrated on these issues, special scripts. On American Idol, there was a public service announcement written by teens on preventing teen pregnancy. So, sometimes you have to look for it a little bit, but I think if you, and we know this from our own research, if you track the amount of attention now being given in the media, and I'm not talking about public service announcements, I mean in programming, in content, there has been a virtual explosion of attention to postponing sex, using contraception, being grown up before you're a parent. And it's the media leaders who are doing this themselves. Now, I understand there are also some things that some of us look at and may wince a bit, but I think we're going in the right direction, and I celebrate a lot of the media leaders for really seeing that they're powerful and that they can help.
Give us, in just our last few minutes here, give us some do's and don'ts.
For parents or for
parents, yeah. I mean, I think one of the things we don't think about is when you start talking about it is probably way before you're ready as a parent.
Right.
But your child is already old enough and you just don't feel like it.
That's right.
So give us some do's first.
Well, first of all, parents need to do just what you alluded to, which is do talk. And as we often say, it's not the talk, it's an 18-year conversation. And the good news is that popular culture, as we were just describing, every few days something happens in the news or on a television show or something where you can turn to your 7-year-old, your 12-year-old, and say, what do you think about that? Let me tell you what I think about that and have a conversation. Here's another do. Do have conversations, don't have lectures.
Right.
Do have lots of little conversations. Don't have one awkward sort of thing at sort of 16 where everybody just wants to die because it's so embarrassing.
I had one of those.
Yes, we all did. I remember my mother would grip the steering wheel and I would think her knuckles would pop out of her skin because she was so uncomfortable. Understand that even if there's no conversation going on in the home, there's an enormous amount that's already going on in media and in the peer group. So the way to think about it is everybody else is talking to your children. You need to do it too. If your children ask you about sex, birth control, whatever, don't assume they're having sex. They're hearing about it. They need to know. They want to understand. So don't misinterpret their questions to be sort of self-reports on their own behavior. Here's another very important cautionary tale. Don't let your young sons or daughters get romantically involved with someone who's significantly older. It's a recipe for a power difference, often early sex for the younger person, and a lot of risk.
How significant is significantly older?
Well, you know, we sort of say 3 years. I mean, if you have a 15-year-old daughter, or son for that matter, who's romantically involved with someone 19 or 20, it's a recipe for risk. So just be prudent and careful. Know your children's friends. Know your children's friends' family. And I also think it's important to have a point of view. We're not just chit-chatting, and at some point parents need to say in a warm way, this is what I hope for you, and here's why. We have to take the time to explain why it is that we want them to postpone sexual activity. We have to explain why it is we think sex has meaning and it's important and it's not to be taken casually. You know, people may not understand that, especially in this culture. Lots and lots of communication, two-way.
Sarah Brown, thank you very much for being with us here today.
Thank you for being in, you know, having me here in New Mexico. It's wonderful to leave Washington, D.C. for a bit. I can guarantee that.